Good morning to all of you. I am really glad to be a part of this academic discussion, and the topic is no doubt topical, but then it is at the same time a stupendous task to speak something about the voices of English poets from the Northeast that consists of eight sisters. Northeast is a very difficult construct, and Professor Udan Mishra says it is an illusionary construct, and Sanjeev Barua says it is a politically constructed construct. One is fictional illusion and the other one is politically constructed construct. And the first word illusion goes back to the tragic legacy of British colonialism. India was subjected to the colonial hegemony of the Britishers thanks to the stalwarts of our Indian national movement who set India free. This is how the tragic legacy of colonialism is still working in us. That is the fruit of strenuous labor which our forefathers have put in, including late Gopinath Bordoloi, for making India free. And then this has a direct repercussion on the evolution of Indian English poetry. 19th century was the most fertile period where India saw the rise of the Renaissance, because it had its counterpart in the Western world in 16th century England. In fact, it started in Italy. But Indian Renaissance was different from the Western Renaissance. That was a liberation of the self, but Indian Renaissance was a liberation against the tragic colonial legacy. Indian writing English had its humble beginning with what Edward Said says, the spirit of protest and the spirit of resistance. And this was politically manifested in form of the Indian War of Independence. So right from Palasi, Battle of Palasi, through Sipahi Mutiny of 1857, down to the Indian War of Independence, which was stoutly steered through by Mahatma Gandhi, Indian writing English had its humble beginning at that critical juncture, where the poets who started writing in English were sufficiently nourished and nurtured by British language and British culture. And among them, Raja Rammohan Rai. And then we had in Bengal, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar and Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, and subsequently followed by Sharat Chandra Chattopadhyay. And subsequently we had another movement called Romanticism or Neo-Romanticism in form of Taru Dutta, Sri Aurobindo, Rabindranath Tagore and Sarojini Nair. This is how Indian Renaissance was multifarious. Indian writing in English in 19th century had dual dimension. One is protesting against the Britishers, though we have inherited from their language. Radharaman Rao was well versed in English language and English thought. He introduced British policy on the one hand. And there was another group who was trying to revive our long handed down tradition of the Mahabharata, the Upanishadic tradition and the Puranic tradition. And Sita, Savitri, Aurobindo wrote a book on Savitri, and Sarojini Naidu took over this myth of Radha and Krishna to justify true love. That is still continuing. And then when we talk about true love in Indian tradition, we talk about Radha and Krishna. Therefore, their argument is our mythical method cannot be simply forgotten. Under the circumstances, Indian Renaissance had its multifarious dimensions, and I would just broadly take four phases of Indian writing in English. The first phase is the age of pioneers, which starts from 1820 to 1870. It was just steered through Henry Louis Vivian Derozio. What was the greatest contribution of Derozio to the formation of Indian writing in English poetry is the continuation of the Romantic and Victorian ideas. The Romanticism is strangeness added to beauty, the Renaissance of wonder. And he said, extraordinary development of imaginative sensibility. Someone says, liberation of the soul. Best war in best order. Wordsworth says, spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. And the Victorians continued Romanticism, distorted from, says Rigui and Kazami. But Derozio stuck to the Romantic tradition on the one hand and the Victorian tradition on the other. Victorian tradition taught us Romanticism in a twisted way, because science has already defeated Victorians. You know, Victorian crisis, Victorian conflict, Victorian compromise, There was science on the one hand, Charles Darwin's theory of original species was there, and then the traditional romantic tradition was still disturbing. So Victorians were in a crisscross road, how to do, what to do, whether we shall stick to religion on the one hand, or we shall follow the calls of industrial evolution or Charles Darwin's theory of species or evolution and species. That's why this oscillation between science and religion, which characterizes Victorian temper, was also having a direct impact on the poetry of Henry Donahue. Then came Michael Madhusudan Dutta, Kashi Prasad Ghosh. This is the first stage of pioneering of Indian English poetry. And then we come to the most vital stage, which is called the era of Indian Renaissance. So the first stage is the stage of pioneers, Henry Donahue, Michael Madhusudan Dutta, Kashi Prasad Ghosh. The second stage, most important stage, the era of Indian Renaissance, I have already introduced. From 1870 to 1900, where you had this Tufail Zilani and Rabindranath Tagore, C. Aurobindo, Sarojini Naidu, Harindranath Chattopadhyay. That was the stage of a kind of political awakening. I have already told national movement was going on. The third stage is the era of independence. And after you got independence, there was a desire for coming away from the legacy of Britishers to stand on their own feet. And this is a stage which was steered through by great professors of English. The great man from Bombay University, Nassim Ezekiel. He was one of the five stalwarts. And who were the other four? Another is my teacher, Padma Shri Jayanta Mahapatra. And then another man was A.K. Ramanujan. And one single revolutionary lady, Kamala Das. So these people, Nassim Ezekiel, A.K. Ramanujan, Kamala Das, and Jayanta Mahapatra, these four stalwarts, steered through, and they wanted to give a new dimension to Indian English poetry post-independent era, which is completely different from the tragic legacy of. This is the stage under which they were also influenced by the modern poets such as T.S. Eliot, W.B. Yeats, Gerald Manley Hopkins, who warranted that there should be new experiments in poetry. Padma Shri Jayanta Mahapatra. He emphasizes on technique. They are more interested in technique. Poetry does not thrive through things only. But the way you present, that is more important. That Professor Mahapatra is still at the age of 92. There was a special technique he was talking. Montes technique. And another technique which he has passed invite from WBS called exfoliation of images. It is a clustering of images. Clustering of images. Images related to images, interrelated images. That is a brilliant technique which he has imbibed from WBS technique called exfoliation of images. This is how images must be interlaced, interconnected in such a way that they will stand for what R.P. Moore said, structure and texture in neutral cinema. Because each stanza is connected with the subsequent stanza. Each image is connected with the next image. This is what we call structure and texture, because a poem is a composite unit. This is the technique which they followed from these modern poets like T.S. Eliot, W.B. Yeats, and Gerald Manley Hopkins. Hopkins gave a beautiful technique called sprung rhythm. So this is how they were also influenced by the question of existentialism, phenomenology, absurdity. Modern poetry took a new shape, and gradually it was proliferated into different corners of India, and North East not an exception. As I've already told you, North East starts with this poetry of protest. You ask me to encapsulate the very nature of Indian writing in English in North East, a special reference to poetry, I should say North East English poetry started with this note of protest. In other words, we say it is a poetry of protest. Now this protest is many-sided because it is far away from the mainstream. First of all, it is a protest against historiography. Mainstream historiographers, whom we criticize as elitist historiographers and bourgeois historiographers, they have neglected North East. They talk about only hero worship, which is called by Thomas Carlyle, six forms of hero worship. But what about those people who have rebelled, sacrificed themselves? Thousands and thousands of people have become victims of British bullets. They have never been given a dignified page in the historiography. Therefore, North East revolted against this mainstream historiographers called elitist and bourgeois historiographers, and hence comes the word subaltern historiography. Subaltern means those who belong to inferior, marginalized, downtrodden class of the society, who
who have never been recognized by the mainstream. And that is, in Marxist term, we say bourgeois versus proletariat, rich versus poor. And Northeast poetry has become a mouthpiece to voice our concerns, our social concerns, social disintegration, ethnic clashes, violences, political politics of power, what Michel Foucault said, politics of power, dynamics of power, social exclusion. That way, that is a plethora of problems. The ethnic clashes, violence, and the movements that have been springing up, mushroom growth in Northeast, is nothing but the result of this neglect. This neglect of the historiography, political discrimination, social inequality, because Northeast is a mosaic of a pluralistic society where more than 200 caste, creed, community, ethnic group. But then, how to go about? It is therefore necessary that we should write our problems in our own voice, in subaltern voice. So these are the problems which confront the Northeast English poet. How to protect identity of my community, identity of my ethnic group, identity of my culture. When you go to post-colonial discourse, we are usually confronted with these three terms: colonialism, post-colonialism, and neo-colonialism. So tragic legacy continues. Our poets from the Northeast are very much disturbed and suffocated by this, which has posed formidable threats to protect and preserve our identity. Whether it is Assamese identity, or Boro identity, or Karbi identity, or Dimas identity, or Mizo identity, or Naga identity. Everywhere this identity crisis prevails with paramount significance. Now with this background lecture, I will jump to Arunachal Pradesh. I strongly believe that our ethnic identity can be well protected through respect for our indigenous culture. So the word indigenous was used by Mamung Dai and Mamung Dai's counterpart here in Nagaland, a professor of English, Temsula Ao. Both Mamung Dai and Temsula Ao were very much vigilant about the ecological imbalance, which is a part of eco-criticism now. Eco-criticism can be taken as a powerful tool to study Northeastern poetry. You approach Mamung Dai's Legend of Pan's Midsummer lyrics from the standpoint of eco-criticism. But unfortunately, our nature is mishandled, assaulted, and Mamung Dai's poetry speaks about how the voices of protest are coming not through human beings but through nature. The river cries, she has personified the river, river poets. The river cries, as a woman, I am misbehaved, I am assaulted. This is nothing, a kind of symbolic treatment of women in the Northeast in the context of political disintegration, political movements, extremist movement. Mamung Dai is more suggestive than Temsula Ao. To make a comparative study of Temsula Ao and Mamung Dai, you find Mamung Dai speaks so powerful evocative symbols that the rocks cry, the mountains cry. One poem is there on mountain, has double meaning. Mountain stands for ascendance, climbing up to a higher world of utopia. And on the other hand, mountain is crying. But Temsula has come down and out with a spirit of protest against colonial hegemony on the one hand and the hegemony of the government. Everywhere you find in Northeast literature, the spirit of protest comes out, and Mamung Dai is presenting men's problem in relation to the problem of nature, the ecological condition, and calls upon the readers of her poetry to look at a sound ecosystem. What is an ecosystem? Ecosystem consists of a healthy balancing of the biotic and abiotic elements. Biotic elements, biology, consisting of botany, world of plants. Zoology, consisting of world of animals. And abiotic elements refers to the primordial elements, plants, other things like fire, air, earth, water, etc. So this is how Mamung Dai calls upon the readers of Northeast to respect poetry, to read poetry and feel that the natural world must be respected. And you know, animism is a powerful part of the tribal culture because they find some spirit nature. Like our Hindus worshipping Banadevi, you know. We worship a peepal tree, banyan tree, neem tree. That shows that is a direct impact of Vedic ecology, where the Vedic poets invoke fire, water, earth, all sacred rivers. When you start any ritual, How do you start your marriage? The priest invokes all the sacred rivers of India.
Gange cha Jamune chaiva Godavari Saraswati Narmade Sindhu Kaveri Jalesmin Sannidho Bhava. O Ganga, O Sindhu, O Kaveri, O Narmada, Kaveri Saraju Mahendra Tanaya Sharmapati Renuka Shipra Vedamati Mahasuranadi Chitrutpa Ganduki Punnam Punnatale Pavitra Saitam Kurvan Tute Mangalam. Let all gods and goddesses come with you. O all sacred rivers of India, you come and you bless us. Let us recognize our own land, our virgin forest, our mountains and fountains, our flowers and foliages. Yes, Mamandaya referred to the beautiful sonorous sound of the rivers. This is the final message of Mamandaya. Heaven is here. I am reminded of Robert's first poem, Birches, and after a picking, where it says, Earth is the right place for love. Here is paradise itself. Therefore, Mamandaya praises Adi culture, Adi people, Adi society. The anxiety and angst of the people, all these things have been brilliantly articulated in Mamandaya's midsummer survival lyrics, river poems, and wonderful book, The Legend of Pens. I quote, I thought the river is a woman, a country, a name, a note of music trapped in the white current, a sheet of paper carrying a sacred map. The skyline is where it begins, between the darkness and the summit, in the birthplace of thirst. I thought the river is a woman. See, what a wonderful personification. Personification is not in which the animate and inanimate objects are attributed with different qualities. That is the greatest contribution of Mamandaya. Now I come to Temsula Ao. And in Temsula Ao, who was a renowned professor of Nehu, we find how Temsula Ao wants to protect her ethnic group, Ao tribe. So Mamandaya is evocative, symbolic, and Temsula is for revolutionary. And because she always criticizes the politics and the socio-political condition of Nagaland, she cries for peace. And that is a call for all Indians, you know. I am going back to that Upanishad again, where you find every Upanishad ends with the call for peace. That is hypocrisy. After the puja is over, the priest satisfied the fire with the ghee, no? Agni Nirbapana. Do you know what is that? O Agni Shanti, Oshadaya Shanti, Vanaspataya Shanti, O forest, O mountains, O gods, O goddesses, whom I have invoked here to this puja, be happy and go back. What a wonderful! This is pure hypocrisy. And she is calling for an Upanishad, you say, after every mantra they say, Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. In all Upanishad you find, this is called Shanti Patha, invoking peace. This is the thing which influenced your Western poetry as earlier, are borrowed from Brihadaranyak Upanishad. Datta, Dayadham, Damyata, Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Datta, Dayadham, Damyata, Damankara, control yourself. Datta, give charity, Buddhist concept. Dayadham, be kind, Daya. Damyata, control yourself, destructive passion. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. In the context of the First World War, Westland is a pessimistic text that calls upon humanity to bring in peace. Her primary hypothesis is to diffuse tension in favor of peace. So Temsula Ao is a seeker of peace. I am quoting a few lines from Temsula Ao. Stripped of all our basic certainties, we strayed from our old ways. Revival of the past. How both the poems are nostalgically longing for their past. And let our soul mountain, mountain is a symbol, veritable metaphor, that stands for soul. Mountain is not a lifeless symbol of barbarity or fear. Mountain is the symbol of the soul of the Northeast. In all the poems you find, mountain is the extended metaphor. So mountain stands for soul. And let our soul mountain recede into a tiny ant hill. Let us be humble, ant hill, symbolizing simplicity. Let us go back to the land of crystalline purity and primal simplicity instead of surrendering to barbarism. He calls upon the readers and the future poets, let us follow the ant hill, not this mountain. Let us be softened. Let us hope for peace. Let us search for our identity in an amicable way so that the tension will be diffused and the war will come to an end. You remember Leo Tolstoy's novel, War and Peace. The only solution for war is peace. Knowing it fairly well that the other name of war is death and destruction. This is the relationship between human world and natural world, between individual and society, between man and neighbor, between man and society, man and nature, man and God. Both Temsula and Mamongai want that we should develop the art of amity, fraternity and peace to have an integrated vision of homogeneity rather than heterogeneity. North East is a pluralistic mosaic of different castes and different groups. Let us live in peace. And that is the message of eco-criticism. Live and let others live. Into a tiny ant hill and we schooled our minds to become the ideal tabula rasa. Let us forget that we are arrogant. Tabula rasa refers to the so-called sophisticated world of intelligence and arrogance. Let us remain in a state of what romantics say, Rousseau say, pristine purity and primal innocent and natural man. Go back to that primal stage of innocence, where you can live with innocence, knowing it fairly well that man is mortal. Let us live with peace and happiness and amity. That is a brilliant call for the future. Let us have that ideal tabula rasa. So she was also an eco-critical poet, eco-conscious poet, vigorously voicing her concern for nature and criticizes man's anthropocentric vision in favor of ecocentric vision. This is the primary call of eco-criticism. Let us not be selfish. Let us not be Robinson Crusoe. The first lesson of anthropocentric man is found in Daniel Defoe's novel. Robinson Crusoe was the first colonial man who dangerously exploited nature, not for the benefit of the society, but for the benefit of his own self. So this is how Temsurao wants that let us not be Robinson Crusoe, let us be men, live like men, and let our ecosystem also work. Let us live and let others live. So nothing in God's world, in the ecosystem, is without a purpose. Let us respect others, whether it is reptile or deer or animal or bar or man or mountain or fountain or flowers and foliage. Let us respect nature, protect nature, deal nature with an ecocentric vision rather than anthropocentric. This is the sum and substance of the poem Stone People. In Assam, very few poets have written English poetry. However, in Professor Tilottama Mishra's anthology of Oxford writings in Northeast India, there are poems accommodated, poems that have been originally written by poets of Assam in Assamese but translated into English. I will touch a few poems so that I will give justice to poets from Assam, and because they are translated. Translation is an art. The translation is the best medium to know each other. I will come to two, three important poems of Assamese literature whose poems have been translated by a great translator from Cotton College, Pradeep Acharya. And among these Assamese poets, the names are Neomani Phukan, Nabokanta Borua, Hiren Bhattacharya, and then Dilip Kumar, Hare Krishna Deka, Anubhav Tulasi, and Samir Tanki. These poets have been translated, and their poetry is characterized by historical consciousness, which is the part and parcel of the entire Northeast mosaic. We must know our history, what were we in the past, so that we derive inspiration from history. What Eliot said, past is not past. It is not the pastness of the past, it is the continuation of the present in the past in the present, with a hope for its continuance in the future. Therefore, history is never a matter of the dead past. History is a continuation of the legacy, the tradition in present as well as in the future. This is Eliot's concept of tradition, which many Assamese poets do follow, because you stick to your own culture, Assamese culture, Bihu culture, you remember. These are part and parcel of our collective, what Carl Gustav Jung said, our collective unconscious. They have been a part and parcel of Assamese unconscious. So Assamese poets are characterized by historical consciousness, many-sided psychological turmoils of the modern man. Assamese poetry carries this class, dialectical class of many things. And the burden of colonial exploitation, which is hanging heavily in every zone, whether it is Arunachal or Tripura, the colonial exploitation is hanging over. The voice of protest, resistance, vindication of nationalism. So Assamese poets are also very much vigilant about this realistic position of how to protect our Assamese identity and culture, and then the indigenous cultural situation. I start with Hiren Bhattacharya, whose poem has been translated under the title The Lone Prayer for the Poetry. He calls upon the poets of the 20th century that a poet must be a free soul. The poets are by nature free souls, and and they must be realistic enough to bring to fore the anemic, morbid and devastating questions of reality of the society. That means a poet is essentially a realistic man, a free soul, without any favor and fear. He must bring the realistic condition of the society into his literary presentation. A poet cannot idle away in the ivory tower like romantics. A poet is not an escapist. A poet is a down-to-earth realist. The poet's voice rebounds from harshness in unrivaled echoes. On the tip of the pen, the poet's soul, the promised poem, the freedom of art, a hymn of sorrow in the low voice of the starved poet. He highlights the mechanism of the poetic sensibility. My pen is the hammer in the blacksmith's hand. Image of blacksmith hammering at iron products. I hammer words. What I am hammering, the rod is my words. I hammer words into shape, sharp shape. And farmer's ploughshare, the golden sita on the furrows. How myth is also co-related into reality. That is a technique which Hiren Bhattacharya has given to the future generations of Ashmith poets. Myth is inextricably blended with reality. So myth and reality, though myth is by nature fictional, but myth is given a realistic orientation, hence the importance of the myth sita. I extract from the brains of hard timber, was trained by the blood of experience, like sure arrows from the Santal's male bow, Santal's of Midnapur. So is Pragana, they fight with bow. So my words are not soothing ivory towers. My words are not the five flower arrows of God of love, Damde. So he said, my arrows of poetry are not arrows of romanticism, are not arrows of God of love. They are arrows of harsh reality, which can be compared to the arrows of the Santals fighting for their identity, fighting for their redressal of their suffering. So this is how Hiren Bhattacharya sees poetry for revolution, for a regeneration of a new society. Now we come to a Jorhat-born poet from Riyadh in Nagaland. He is Mona Lisa Sankhisa, the reputed poet of the volume Weapons of Wars, correlated with Hiren Bhattacharya. Volume is Weapons of Wars of Pages of Pen. She is alliterative line. She is a poet not of cheap red leather. She is a poet whose pages constitute pages of pain, sufferings of the society. And she employs, like Hiren Bhattacharya employing the myth of Sita, she employs the mythical method. I am borrowing a word from Elizabeth Drew, who wrote a book on the poetry of T.S. Eliot, the mythical method in Elizabeth T.S. Eliot's poetry. Like Hiren Bhattacharya employs the mythical method and writes a brilliant poem on your Mahabharata Brahmaputra. She writes a beautiful poem on another myth, because Assamese culture is inseparably attached to Brahmaputra. What? Bhupen Hazarika says, Mahabahu Brahmaputra. The name of the poem is Mist Over Brahmaputra. In this poem, she employs mythical method to poetry by characterizing Brahmaputra as Brahma's son. See how mythical consciousness in modern Indian poetry runs from Delhi to Cap Cameron, from Arab Sea to Arunachal Pradesh. The whole of India stands united through mythical method. She converses with Brahma's son and shares her feelings with the river, and she said finally, river can never be separated from culture. This is the message of the poem. Wonderful message for the new generation of poets of 21st century in the Northeast. Poetry cannot be separated from culture. Now we come to Manipur, one of the most revolutionary poet under the name Robin S. Gangam, a bilingual poet equally comfortable in Manipuri on the one hand and in English on the other. Very, very topical, realistic, fearless. The Strange Affairs is a wonderful poem which has political orientation. And he talks about the political life of the entire Northeast India. It has become an extended metaphor because it has extended ramification of the entire Northeast. And in this poem, he talks about an individual desiring freedom against social oppression. Freedom from social system, freedom from political system, freedom for the so-called colonial and neo-colonial impositions. So these are the three ramifications, cries of freedom. Having my trajectory into the poetry of Robinson, Gangam, I am reminded of Alan Paton's novel, Cry the Beloved Country, where he wants that an individual, in order to live in a dignified society, must be free from taboos, social taboos, political taboos, economic oppression and the so-called political, colonial and neo-colonial impositions. But he is decisively affected by his childhood in Manipur. A poem for mother, name of mother is Palem Apokbi. The poem begins with the name of the mother. Oh mother, Palem, mother who gave birth to me to be a man. See the vision of a child. The child envisages and recognizes the mother. Timeless thanks to you, oh my dear mother, you have shown the light of this world and you have given me birth to be a responsible citizen of the society. In the first two lines, the poet vindicates the relevance and the efficacy of the birth of a child in a society. The child is not a parasite. Here, the child anticipates, thanks the mother that she has given birth and allowed the child to see the beauty of this whole world. Not only the beauty, but also she has thrown a challenge for the child how to become responsible citizens of the world, citizens of society and serve the society. And 10 years ago, now this is nostalgia. Memory, myth and memory, these are two important tools of Northeast poetry. I keep on telling in course of my lecture, myth on the one hand and memory and nostalgic longing for getting back to the childhood days on the other. Now these hills have grown on me. I have grown not only, these hills have also grown on Chidi. Amicable affinity between man and nature. Man is growing, the child is growing into a young man, the hills are also growing. Chidi. Indescribable relationship between man and nature. The child said, I am going as much as the hills are growing. I am seeing your painfully shy son with an avengers appetite. The boy who lost my teeth after untying your ladder. I have troubled you. I was very naughty in my childhood. Oh mother, you have taken a lot of pain to thrash me, to beat me, but I am still your avantu santan. Purely an autobiographical person. And steady development of the child. That reminds me of Wilhelm Soma also, the tradition where a personality is developed through different stages, steady development, as you find Wordsworth's prelude, which is called Wilhelm Soma. So the boy who lost many teeth after untying your ladder, and I am also your dreaming eyed lad. Yes, again repeated, he's coming back. I know, my mother, while giving me birth, you had lots of hopes and dreams that to fulfill the dream. This is an experience in terms of confession. This is example, one of the best examples of poetry as confession. Confession is of three types, spiritual confession, and romantic confession, and secular confession. This is neither a spiritual confession nor a romantic confession, but a secular confession as a simple child before a mother that I will try my best, level best, to get me to be an established lad in the society. With an avenger's appetite, the boy who lost many teeth after untying your ladder, and I am also your dreamy-eyed lad who gave you difficult times, you have suffered a lot. Difficult times when Manipur was experiencing extremism. So what he said? You have taken much pain. You have seen the horrible condition of the volatile situation. Great poetry is highly suggestive. So this is a beautiful poem where in one word, oh my mother, you gave me birth during your difficult times. One word only suffices the entire political volatile situation. How my mother has carried me for 10 months. With all responsibilities he has given me part, which I will try my level best to materialize and fulfill. You told your children that money and time do not grow on trees and I could never learn to keep up with them. It is not that I have forgotten what you have come to mean to me, though I abandoned much and left so little of myself for others to remember me. He regrets that he has lost his precious moments in childhood. He mature now, he remembers that he could have done better and many more things which could have been done. Message is this, we must respect time, we must respect our mother, we must respect and recognize the sufferings of our mother, our parents. I could never learn to, still I will try to remember me. I know how you work your fingers to the bone. See, a candid confession, a candid eulogy in place of the service and sacrifice of the mother for hearing the child. I know how you work your fingers to the bone as all mothers do. Mother is the fountain source of inspiration, irrespective of caste, creed and color and sex and time and place. Mother is a universal figure. Mother stands for love. We are all sons and daughters of the boundless mother who stands for the fountain source of mercy. This is a lesson on mother-son relationship, one dimension, confessional poem, another dimension, and the recognition of the child that he will try his best to fulfill the dreams and desires of her mother. The third level of interpretation. So,
aging husband and liberated daughter-in-law worried about us for a long time. Comment on daughter-in-law who never recognized their mothers and mother-in-law. All mothers too for unmarried sons, aging husband and liberated daughter-in-law worried about us for a long time. Your lips could not burdening a smile. Lines have furrowed your face and first sign of snow are on your hair. Right from your youth till your beautiful face is wrinkled and your hair grows gray. A mother is a mother. Whether you are a young mother or you are wrinkled with age, the folded lips and folded cheeks, you are always the fountain source of love and affection. Today, now he's coming to the conclusion, as on every day you must have risen with temple bells before the cup grows, swept the floors and other day after the sacred bath, cooked the remainders of us. This is the spiritual side of mother. Mother is the best goddess at home. How much of tenacity you get up early in the morning when the cock crows, and how you ring the bell, how you are part and parcel of the Manipuri women. Manipuri is a wonderful place of Vishnu Priya Vishnu. And the reference is there to Red Bath. Justify that Manipur mothers are by nature spiritual. The whole poem is a confession of a candid shaman. Now we are coming to the last. Returning every dusk from the bazaar. Ideal picture of an ideal mother is given in this poem. Your head laden with baskets. I am sorry, mother. But a beautiful conclusion, dramatic and tone of repentance. The poem concludes with a note of repentance. You are a fountain source of love on the one hand and the responsibility, social responsibility on the other. These are the things which the son recognizes. Finally, he says that he has learned nothing. Still, he will try. As long as he is alive, to remember his mother, all fidelity and faithfulness. Forgive me, see the confession, for all your dreams of peace. See, another political reference. This is called intertextuality. History and literature are negotiating here. In every line, he is talking about history. Troubled time, now he says, forgive me for all your dreams. I am not able to fulfill your dreams. Of peace. During your remnant days, I turned out to be a small man with small dreams, living a small life. The word small is repeated 3 times. Candid confession and the full, wholehearted surrender of the son. Poem concludes with a note of repentance, which attains the height of sublimity. In one poem, he laments that he could not change. But in another politically oriented poem, he said, I have changed myself. I have become a ripple, strong man of protest, down and out to protest against all kind of corruption, injustice done to the Manipur society. And this is when the poetic persona appears in the role of a new subaltern who knows how to revolt and protest against the established norms of the society. I left behind many untended hearts. I left in the past memory, mixing with the desire, recollection, and gathering courage and revenge to take revenge against the established system. And here is the voice of the new subaltern, which is the brilliant hallmark of Northeast poetry. As a boy, I was made a steady growth. This is a pure example of the instrument. Because steady growth of the personality of Robinson is suggestively developed, which is applicable to all human beings. So as a boy, I was made a sick, mockery, travesty of truth. A human being is dehumanized to the level of a sheep. The society belittled me. I have become a sheep. I have become a goat. And my 2 horns of my goat have been adorned with flowers. Chidi, Panchan's satire, Chidi Animal Imagery. Wonderful poem. This is more critical a poem than the other one because there is less imagery, more confession in emotion. Here there is more adroit image making power. Who is a great poet? A great poet is he who is a great image maker. Great poetry is great image making process, as upon said. I think while teaching this poem, a very critical poem, you take note of these things, how the animal imagery frequently alludes to indicate the helpless days of human existence. Human being has become a goat, human being has become a sheep. This is a kind of absurd, ridiculous situation which reminds me of the absurd drama of Samuel Beckett. This is how we make a caricature of ourselves on the stage. Human beings belittle themselves, make a caricature, comic product out of their own self, just to the laughter of the audience. This is the situation. And sometimes we are done under situation, socio-political, cultural situation. Therefore,
here you can apply subaltern discourse, we become situational subaltern and new subaltern. We protest against the system, then you become new subaltern. We are situationally made a boat and a ship, then you become situational subaltern. Like Shylock becoming a situational subaltern in the trial scene in Merchant of Venice. Now, the whole poem can be discussed from the socio-political angle with the help of the development of this animal imagery with special reference to boat and ship, how we become situational subalterns under the pressure of the socio-political circumstances, how sometimes also in an absurd situation we make ourselves subalterns, laughing face. I hope I have been able to speak something, though I was not prepared. I am not a specialist in contemporary poetry. Thanks to Mr. Goswami for introducing me as a specialist, but I say humbly that I am not a specialist. Before I conclude, I would like to say four important things. The whole study of Northeast voices in poetry revealed four important points. We have searched for roots and a desperate cry for protection and preservation of our identity. Third, a spirit of protest against the colonial hegemony, which is continuing still in form of neo-colonial legacy, and a dream, let us say, a utopia, not a dystopia. The word dream is repeated again and again. And the image of mountain in all the poems signifies that let us climb the ladders of perfection despite all trials and tribulations. Let us not be pessimistic. Let us try hard to establish our identity, to oppose the political discrimination, social inequality. Let us transcend what Rabindranath Tagore said in that poem, "Where the mind is without fear, the narrow domestic walls." And finally, since it is a pluralistic society in Northeast, among different castes and creeds and ethnic tribes, I would wind up my lecture with a multicultural message. Let us develop the multicultural vision. Let us live together. Let us talk together. With this message, I would recite few lines from Rabindranath Tagore's beautiful poem, Bharat Tirtha, which will give the message, right message, for the ideal society of Northeast. Hethai arjya, hethai anarjya, sak hun pathan sabe habe lin, milibe milabe jabe na phire, yehi bharate, mahabharate, sagar tiri. This is the greatest message of humanity. Thank you so much.